Jesus, he loves me, he loves me, he is for me, Jesus. greatness of your renown. I have heard all the majesty and wonder of you, King of heaven, humanity. I bow as your love, and wave after wave crashes over. Is over me. You are for us. You are not against us. Champion of heaven, you made a way for all to enter in.
Good morning, Pierce Church.
Congrats on
making it out here on this cold morning. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time.
God is good.
So we're going to start this morning with some responsive reading. So if you guys want to stand. Heavenly Father, you are all powerful, all knowing, all good. You hold us together in the palm of your hand.
May we open our eyes to your goodness this morning.
Jesus, you are our King, yet you walk beside us as we walk beside each other.
From partaking of your body and blood with one another, we are all of the same flesh ourselves, members of the body of Christ.
Holy Spirit, we are your tabernacle. We offer sacrifices of praise to you.
We are singing and praying. Be the incense that fills the holy room.
We confess the sins and shortcomings of our work, our relationships, and our habits.
Forgive us, Father, for we have failed. Wash away the filth and make us holy.
Brothers and sisters, let us draw near to the throne of God, leaving behind all that ensnares us.
Give us freedom, Lord Jesus, from everything that would keep us from your eternal embrace.
Glory to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit.
As it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Amen. Well, just remain standing and we'll sing.
Thank you.
Thank you for this morning. Thank you for bringing us here safely on this cold morning, for providing this space where we can gather. Lord, as we have these walls around us and this roof over our heads on such a cold morning, Lord, we It's easy for us to take for granted the gifts, the things that you provide for us, Lord, the small things. And we're mindful this morning, Lord, of those who are worried, those who are fearful, those who are worried about the roof over their head or the pipes below them, Lord, or the car that won't start. Lord, we pray for those around us who are in need and pray that, Lord, you would use us. Use us as a church, use us collectively, use us individually, Lord, to express your good news and your love to those in need. God, we give you this morning. It's our desire as we gather in this place to not just arrive to check a box or to feel like it's the next thing on our schedule, Lord, but to really come with a sense of expectation that you want to meet us here, that your Holy Spirit wants to speak to us, wants to challenge our assumptions, wants us to think maybe differently today. And so, Lord, help us to open our hands and our hearts as we just sang, to really unfold our hands, Lord, and really open them up to you and say, Lord, what do you have? What do you need to say? What's going on in my mind, in my heart, in my life that I need you to speak into? Will I listen? Will I respond? God, I pray for Audrey as she preaches this morning, Lord. I pray that you would speak through her, Lord, that we would just get a sense of your heart for worship, and you would draw us in and draw us closer to you. So, Lord, now we join our voices together and pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Before you're seated, would you turn to some people nearby and say good morning? Again, good morning. Glad that you're with us this morning, and just looking forward to continuing our series here in just a moment on marks of a healthy church. And this morning, we're going to talk about what it means for us collectively and individually to engage in worship, authentic worship. And so Audrey's going to be leading us in that in a moment. Just a few announcements that we want you to be aware of, and those are in our In the Know video. So we're going to play that for you now.
Good morning and welcome to Pierce Church. Here's what's happening so you can be in the know. Pierce Youth is back in session for 2024, and we have a special Pierce Youth Game Night on Sunday, January 21st. Come join your friends from Pierce Youth Group or bring new friends to come play board games, card games, and have fun together. We'll be in the Pierce Cafe area from 6 to 8 p.m. playing games and eating snacks. Feel free to bring your favorite game or play one of the many we'll have here at the church. Don't like games? Don't worry. Just come hang out and eat snacks with your friends. We hope to see you Sunday, January 21st from 6 to 8 p.m. In case you missed it last week, we're excited to announce our next lead pastor here at Pierce Church as Chad Yoder. Chad comes to us from Goshen, Indiana, where he has been serving at the Life Center, another congregation within the Global Methodist Conference. Chad and his family will move to Upland in February, and Chad will begin on Sunday, February 18th. Stay tuned for more information on how we can collectively give Chad, Aaron, and their four daughters a warm welcome here at Pierce Church. Those are all of our announcements for this morning. Now you're in the know.
I'm going to be reading this morning from the book of Psalm 95, 1 through 7. Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand we are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks among belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down and worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care.
Well, good morning. Boy, so this is really weird I've been up here, standing right here for probably hundreds of hours. I was just thinking about that. It's like, I don't usually talk to you though, so this is feeling very strange, and it's a real privilege to be able to talk with you about something that is so near and dear to my heart that I think about and pray about every day of my life, and have been for the past 17 years. I've been doing this at this church, and it's just been the joy of my life to be able to serve with this amazing group of people up here and with all of you. It's just a really unique place and a really beautiful place, so thank you for having me today. If you don't know me, my name's Audrey Felger. My husband and I started coming here back when we were in Taylor, and we've been hanging out here ever since. We've got three kids. Sam's over there with Jacob, and there are two other ones who are, I asked my oldest son, would you rather stay in the sanctuary and hear me preach or go and help at kids' church? He was like, kids' church, obviously. He was like, I hear you talk every day of my life. I was like, okay, he's 12 years old, so I get it. But yeah, that's who I am. And so today we are diving right in to talking about worship. We have been in the concept of intentional faith formation last week, and we're going into talking about generosity, hospitality, and missions and service in the next few weeks. So this series that we've concocted is we're calling it We Are. We Are, and five traits of a healthy church, of a healthy bride of Christ. These are five attributes of who we hope to be individually and in a body. So forming our faith, worshiping, generous, hospitable, and serving. This is also a neat sermon series because you heard Kevin talk last week. I'm going to talk today, and coming up we're going to have some other friends from the church that you might not ever have met before, and they're going to be bringing the next messages in the coming weeks. So that's part of what's going to make this really neat. We get to talk about who we are principle-wise, and also you get to see who we are face-wise. You get to meet some new people. So it's been a fun series to plan, to think about. So worship. Worship, that's where we are today, worship. Now, we use the word worship a lot, and we use the word worship in usually a very specific way. So I don't know if you've heard someone say before, now we will enter our time of worship. Have you heard this? You've said it, and usually what is meant by that is we're going to enter a time of singing. We're going to sing some songs together, right? Or you might have said, I'm going to go to worship. So like you're talking about gathering with a group of people and singing songs together, right? Again, with the singing, right? And that is true. Worship can exhibit itself in singing, but when we use that word in such a slim, narrow way, we rob it of so much of its power and its breadth and its depth. Worship in the Bible means so many more things than just singing a song together, okay? And so that's kind of where I want to land today. I know I'm the one that always sings the songs, but I'm not going to be talking about singing songs today. I'm going to be talking about the vastness of the idea of worshiping God, okay? So in the Bible, the word worship is used in a lot of different ways. In the Hebrew, there are, I don't even know, if you, it depends on who you read, you'll get different numbers, but there are between like 7 and 10 different words for worship in Hebrew, and in the Greek, there's about the same amount of different words for worship, and they mean things all across the gamut, spanning from obedience, sacrifice, kneeling, laying down, opening your hands, raising your hands, shouting, singing, dancing, all these different words, this colorful, like rainbow of words in the Old Testament. And what we've done in English is just go, oh, these are worship. And then we just went, oh, worship, singing. And so we've like lost all of this. So when we talk about worship, sometimes we don't have the intricacy of what it originally was intended to mean in the Bible. So I'm going to actually go through real quick just some stories of worship in the Bible. I think we learn best by listening to stories. That's why Jesus used stories, right? So I'm going to start way back in the very beginning and talk about just some little highlights. A lot of you who are familiar with your Bible will already know these. And I'm not even going to put them on the screen. I'm just going to boop, 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 go through them real fast. So we're going to go back to Abraham. So Abraham's story is actually the first time the word worship appears in the Bible. And it is the story where God asks Abraham to take his son up the mountain, sacrifice his son. And so in this story, this is the first word that we see the word worship. Abraham says, we will go up the mountain and worship and come back down. That's pretty different than the way we usually use the word, isn't it? Think of, that's a response to the presence of God, to the call of God, and a response characterized by sacrifice and obedience, right? So let's fast forward to Moses. Moses, when he encountered the presence of God, God said, I will pass by. And he passed by Moses on the mountain. Moses hid his face, fell down to the ground, right? And it says he bowed down to the ground and worshiped. And when Moses did that, he said, if I have found favor in your sight, Lord, please go with us. Forgive our iniquity and sin and take us as your inheritance. So Moses' response to God's presence was to fall down, worship, ask for forgiveness, and ask for more of God's presence. Okay, so there's Moses' story. We see worship again in Job. Job, if you remember, lost everything. He lost his family, his possessions, all of his animals, his everything just came crashing down on him. He even lost his health. He got sick. And Job's response when he gets the bad news is he goes into deep mourning and grief. And simultaneously, the text says that he worshiped, says he fell to the ground and worshiped. And he said, blessed be the name of the Lord. So he's worshiping even in his grief. And again, his response to God is one of submission, obedience, sacrifice. There's another place that I'll call to your attention in the Old Testament in 2 Chronicles, where the glory of God descends like physically on the temple, right? And it says that all of the people, all of the Israelites, saw the fire coming down and the glory of the Lord above the temple. They knelt on the pavement with their faces to the ground and they worshiped, gave thanks to the Lord, saying, he is good, his love endures forever. So what I see in all of these stories is this common thread of responding to the glory, to the presence of God with obedience, submission, and wonder, right? Do you see that too? So let's move into the New Testament and where Jesus actually enters the picture. Jesus, who is God, is worshiped in the New Testament. And the first time that anybody worships him is actually the wise men who come all this way bringing gifts to worship a baby. It says they kneel down in front of him and offer him their gifts. There's another place where a woman who had lived a sinful life comes to Jesus in somebody's house. She brings along this jar of expensive perfume, and it says that she recognizes who he is. She recognizes who she's standing in the presence of, and she weeps. She anoints his feet with her tears, wipes them with her hair, and she also anoints his feet with this precious, expensive oil that she has, this perfume. And then there's the time where Jesus' disciples were on the water, right, in the boat, and it's nighttime, and suddenly they see Jesus coming across the water, and they're so scared. And there's Jesus, and Peter's even like, let me come out to you, Jesus. And he tries, and Jesus sees him, and Peter kind of goes down, and Jesus grabs him, drags him into the boat. And then all of the disciples, all at once, it says that they fall down in the boat and worshiped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. New Testament worship. So how does the Son of God himself talk about worship? There is one text that most people come back around to, and this is just, it is like masterclass on a New Testament worship, on worship of the Son of God and of God, the Holy One. And Jesus says, as he's talking to the woman at the well, the sinner, the lady who doesn't really understand the real true God, Jesus says, woman, a time is coming and has now come when true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers that the Father seeks. God is Spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the Spirit and in truth. Do we have that on the screen? I'm not really sure. It's an honest question. Is it? Oh, cool. Okay, yeah. So why don't you go ahead like two slides, if you would. Or yeah, that one. That's it. No, back one, sorry. So this little scripture right here, it says, a time is coming and has now come when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. Do you see that? So the thing that the lady says after he says this is like makes it really obvious that she does not actually understand what he's saying. She doesn't actually understand who he is. And so she says this thing that sort of resonates with me, because I kind of feel this sometimes. She's like, well, when the Messiah comes, he'll explain this all to us. So, you know, don't worry. We'll get it later. He'll help us understand it. I don't understand it. And I've looked at this scripture and felt the same way. Like, I don't really understand what it means to worship in spirit and in truth. It feels like kind of a amorphous, like ambiguous kind of way of saying this thing that I want to really like put my claws into and actually be able to hold. But I wanna settle here for a few minutes and really think about what this might actually mean for us. So to worship in spirit and in truth, those are two really different things, same in some ways, right? But different in others. So let's think about the images for each that we see in the Bible. So for the spirit, how is the spirit represented in the Bible, image-wise? I see the spirit being represented as breath, right? As wind, as oil, as a river, and as a fire, right, at the Pentecost, as a dove that comes down onto Jesus. So you get those images in your head? Now, what about truth? Truth has some images associated with it too. Rock, for instance, anchor, foundation, sword. These are really different from each other, but really what this does to understand it this way is it expands the spectrum of forms that our worship can take. So what I hear in this scripture is that true worship is both spirit and truth. Let's throw this next slide up here. This is a like a little graph. Do we have it? Ooh, you might not be able to read that. Can you? I don't know. I pulled this straight out of a study book that I had from worship school. I went to 10,000 Fathers in Mother's Worship School back like 5 years ago maybe, and this has been so helpful to me in my understanding of this verse. So this scripture asks us to worship spiritually and scripturally. It asks us to worship in a spontaneous way and in a substantial way. It asks us to worship in a beautiful way and a thoughtful way. It asks us to be emotional and biblical, passionate and considerate, poetic and prophetic, charismatic and careful. So if you work out only one muscle, right? If you're only lifting on the left side of your body, that is not healthy, right? You're gonna show some signs of unhealth. You're gonna look pretty weird. And if we only exercise one side of this chart, if we're only spontaneous and not substantial, we are not gonna be a whole worshiper. If we are only poetic and not prophetic, we're not gonna be a whole worshiper. So really, the other thing is, if you wanna go deeper into one side of the chart, you actually have to go through the other side. So if you want to become more spiritual, go through the scriptures, right? Okay, so, Jesus actually even talks in his teachings about some of this, like when he's talking to the teachers of the law. Actually, he says to them, "You are honoring me with your lips, but your hearts are far from me, and so you worship me in vain." Well, that's kind of scary. What if we worship God in vain? That's something I want to avoid. And so I want to keep my heart engaged and my brain engaged in worship. One thing that John Piper says that I found, a quote from him, says, "Truth without emotion produces dead orthodoxy. And a church full of artificial admirers, on the other hand, emotion without truth produces empty frenzy and cultivates shallow people who refuse the disciple of rigorous thought. But true worship comes from people who are deeply emotional and who love deep and sound doctrine. Strong affections for God, rooted in truth, are the bone and marrow of biblical worship." So true worship is really just a continuation of the greatest commandment that we have, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind. It is a whole person engagement. It engages the people who are all feeling everything and the ones who are thinking everything. It's an all-inclusive invitation, one that encompasses all the parts and not just the people who are good singers. So I'm gonna put us into another scene from the Bible, another story. This one is in Revelation. So John records worship in heaven. John was taken up in the spirit into the heavens and got to actually see what worship looks like around the throne of God. And this seems crazy to us as we read this, because John had no context for this kind of place, right? He tried. but how do you describe a color you've never seen before? Or a taste that you've never eaten food before? Like when my oldest son was 1 year old, we took him over to Guy Duckwall's house. My boys have always called him Uncle Guy. And Guy made one of his famous lemon meringue pies for little 1 year old Isaac. And Isaac had no experience with something like this. He had only before ever eaten like breast milk and rice cereal and the occasional like sweet potato puree, right? So can you imagine like being a little kid and having this like delectable like lemon meringue pie set in front of you? Like what, how do you, if he even had the vocabulary back then, there is no way he would have been able to describe what he experienced right then. Okay, and so I'm thinking about John's experience probably about the same way. Like, what is this place? And he tried to describe it. And his descriptions are crazy. And they're really hard for us to wrap our minds around because it's so other. It's so different than what we are accustomed to. We don't have the context. And so what he says, I'm gonna read it to you here, okay? I'm sure you've heard this before, and I wonder what you hear this time through. So this is Revelation 4. He says, in the center, around the throne, were four living creatures, and they were covered with eyes in front and in back. The first living creature was like a lion. The second was like an ox. The third had a face like a man. The fourth was a flying eagle. Each of the four living creatures had six wings and was covered with eyes all around, even under its wings. Day and night, they never stop saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come." So like I said, I've read that a lot of times, right? I'm a worship leader, for goodness sake. Like, that's like our theme for, like, oh, how do we want worship to look? I know, let's look at heaven and see how that looks. Let's try to do that. and I somehow have missed this until this week of my life. I read it this week and I was like, I just never even saw that before. And he says it twice. John describes what these creatures look like. And I guess before I'd always looked at it and been like, well, there's one that's like a lion, one like an ox, one like a man, one like an eagle. Okay, all right, that's weird. But how else does he describe them? What else does he say about them? They're covered in everywhere. He says it twice. He says they're covered in eyes. They even had eyes under their wings, okay? Everywhere. And what do we use eyes for? We use eyes to see. So these creatures created specifically for worshiping God can see everything about him. They are constantly in his presence, beholding the Holy One. And I look at this also and I think, well, they never stop. Day and night, they never stop. Like, that's a long time. That's a lot. That's a lot. Don't they get bored? Do they? I mean, what causes them to continue saying, "Holy, holy, holy"? Like, I just wonder if it's because of their eyes. It's because they can see. They can see all of the facets of our God. Our God is so big and so glorious and so beautiful that could it be that every time they look up with all those eyes on their bodies, they see a new little highlight, a new little facet of who God is, and they can't help but say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." And then, oh, there's something else that I didn't see before. "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Oh my goodness, there's another thing about God that I did not notice. "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." Could that be? And do we have eyes to see that? And how do we see that? We only have two eyes. And I think the answer to that is also in the scriptures. And I see it in the Psalms a lot. Psalm 100, for instance, says, "Enter his gates with thanksgiving." As if thanksgiving is the doorway. "Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name, for the Lord is good and his love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations." Perhaps thanksgiving is our way of seeing. is our way of entering into the courts. This is not a practice reserved for singers or professional holy people. It's for not even your quiet devotional time. It's not just for when you're feeling good. It's not just for when you're here in church. I believe that Thanksgiving as a doorway into worship of the living God is available to you every moment, because his glory is hidden in every corner of creation. If we have the eyes to see that glory, our response can only be holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. So what do we do once we see God? What is our response? Romans 12:1. Yeah, I love the way the Message translates this, paraphrases it. It says, so here's what I want you to do, God helping you. Take your everyday, ordinary life, your sleeping, eating, going to work, walking around life, and place it before God as an offering. Because once you see God all around you, every little thing becomes an opportunity for worship. And every room that you're walking through becomes a sanctuary. So why don't we just make it a practice to hand over every little bit, every little moment to him? So as you're washing the dishes, acknowledge the presence of God there, his ownership over all the dishes and all the people who use them, his provision of food, his presence at the table where the dishes were sitting, the goodness of the clean water, the beauty of the soap bubbles. It's not silly, because it leads you into the presence of God. Everything, everything can lead you there. And then our response can be, blessed be the name of the Lord. Or, you are holy, holy, holy. Or, just offering him whatever you're doing. Here, take this. It's yours anyway. I submit it to you. Or maybe it is singing a song. For me, it is. I know not everybody goes there automatically, and I do think it's a good practice to get into. I'm sure a lot of you have really nice shower voices. I know you have good voices in here, too, but man, the shower makes it 100% better, doesn't it? yeah, come audition. But I think I want to land the plane here in this space of Thanksgiving. I want to suggest that perhaps a good practice to sort of take this idea into yourself and allow this to become a part of who you are. I've got one little practice to suggest this week and today even. And it is a little breath prayer. Breath prayers are like little tools to sort of bring us back, right? To remind us, because we constantly need reminding. I know I do. I forget like that. And so I constantly need to be brought back to the truth, to in the spirit, to God's presence. And so this little breath prayer is just a really simple way of bringing yourself back. So I'm going to suggest right now, even, we'll try it. So as you breathe in, think of something that you see God's glory in, something you're grateful for, some place, even a smallest place. Jonathan Seacrest makes fun of me because I was waxing poetic one day before we came out here about how pretty I thought the moss was that was growing in the parking lot, and he laughed and laughed at me. But listen, guys, the moss is gorgeous, and I'm not going to apologize for that. And it brings me back to being grateful for the presence of God, because I think it's such a beautiful thing he's made. And I have the eyes to see it. Praise God. And so right now, just get an image of something. Maybe it's a person, maybe it's a face, because we surely see the presence of God in the faces around us. Just capture that in your thoughts. And as you're breathing in, hold it there. And then as you're breathing out, just whisper, holy, 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 or blessed be the name of the Lord, or thank you, God, or truly you are the Son of God. Right? Okay. So let's try that. Breathe in. Breathe out. Holy, holy, holy. Breathe in. Breathe out. Blessed be the name. One more. Breathe in. Breathe out. You are good and your love endures forever. And suddenly we're in the throne room. Suddenly we see the glory of God. He's given us eyes to see. I'm going to pray for us, and my friends who are going to help lead the last song, you can come on up. God, thank you for leading us into your presence. I ask for eyes to see today for each of the people in this room, that you would open our eyes to your wonder, to your glory. May we see you all around us in every corner of creation. Give us hearts of thanksgiving. Lord, I just ask for you to shine your light on the things around us. Show us your glory. Change our hearts. Change our eyes. Lead us to bow down and worship to you, God, because you are great and you're worthy of every little bit of our praise. Jesus, we love you. Help us to love you more. I pray that in your holy name. Amen. Would you stand with us? And we're going to sing a song right now that actually takes us into the same scene that we just talked about in Revelation.
Slain, holy, holy, see.
Hearts, our whole minds, all of our strength, everything that we have, because you are worth it. Psalm 95, verses 1 through 7 says, "Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is a great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care." Would you extend your hands as you receive the benediction today? Open up our eyes, God, to see you in the ordinary. We do not want to miss you anymore. Open up our eyes to see that every day, everything is burning with the glory of the Lord. Friends, go under his peace.